main, a lot of the following were girls, because the band was full of good-looking men. I think that worried Ted a bit, actually. I think he thought I was going to go through them. Section by section. But suddenly, you know, there was me. I was a girl and something for the male following to look at. People seem to think that, you know, all this sort of mass worship has just started now. I've signed autographs on men's bare chests, on their backs, on their arms. Now, you say I'll never wash again. And then there was a period where they used to want lipstick imprints on the collars of their shirts and their girl, or on their, you know, just about where their heart was, and their girlfriends would embroider the lipstick imprints. I always remember one man came with his wife, and he said, you know, she's pregnant. And she said, yes, and it's your fault. Mine. So evidently she had a good time on the strength of me. You know, I suppose this happened a lot. I used to get loads of letters about, you know, I love your dresses, but I don't suppose you care what the price of coal is. It's a fact.
You also found romance with the band, didn't you?
Yes, I did, actually. The trumpet player, one of the trumpet players in the Heath band, Ronnie Hughes. I started going with Ronnie a few weeks after I joined the band. He gave me a lift home. And then I just started going with him. Men fans didn't care much for it, but then I wasn't married, so I was still available as far as they were concerned. And as far as the girls were concerned, they preferred to think that, oh, well, there's 16, apart from Dickie Valentine and eventually Dennis Lotus, that they could have. And I'd only taken one, as opposed to thinking, oh, well, you know, she's a rival, really, and she might have all of them. But I really don't think I had the stamina, the strength. Besides, they didn't all appeal to me.
Another of Hammersmith's famous sons was bandleader Lou Preager, resident at the Palais for 18 years. He arrived in 1942 and was responsible for booking bands like Ted Heath's, for dreaming up the famous Write a Tune contest, Cruising Down the River was the first winner, and introducing the beauty competition. When he took over, the average was 900 dances a night. To get more onto the floor, he invented a new fashion in dancing, crush dancing.
Now, the boys didn't like to ask because they couldn't dance properly, and the girls were just standing there. And I thought if we put a really terrific rhythm, we might get a crowded floor where not many people could dance properly, and after that it just went spiraling. 2,500, 3,000 odd. And then what we had party dances, of course. Now, this meant the Lambeth Walk and the Cokey Cokey. I was the first band to record the Cokey Cokey. In fact, I refused when my recording manager asked me. I said, that is the biggest load of tripe I've ever heard in my life. How wrong can you be? Rock and roll came out, and the director said, no rock and roll in the ballroom. We don't want any trouble. I said, if you don't have any rock and roll, you don't have Lou Preager or Phil Tate. And, no, I wasn't being funny about this. You know, I just said, this is ridiculous. Rock and roll started. We've got to have it. So we had it. And all the crowd took to it, except the ballroom dancers, because the people we call the good ballroom dancers. And for some reason or other, I think that practically everybody has a natural rhythm, except my very good friends, and they are very good friends, the ballroom dancers. They have a different sort of natural rhythm. It's a flowing, graceful rhythm. I met my wife at the Palais, as did thousands of others. The Palais was a place for romance. You know, music and romance have always gone together. Strauss, all the famous composers, I don't think their music would ever have been as wonderful as it was if it hadn't have had romance in it. And if you take some of the serious music as well, serious music also has romance in it. I mustn't get too serious about this. Let's get back to dance music.